Queens residents come from nearly 200 countries and speak nearly 200 languages. At the library, we speak diversity. Join us as we honor immigrant heritage this month. For more information, visit queenslib.org/immigrantheritage22. National Library Week is from April 3rd through April 9th. Stay connected with Queens Public Library by participating in our programs and services, checking out a book, and more. For more information, visit queenslib.org/libraryweek22. Looking for things to do at Queens Public Library? We've compiled 125 of them. Pick up a booklet at your nearest library location or view the list online at queenslib.org/things to do. Share your journey with us on social media using the hashtag QPL125 and you will be automatically entered into a drawing for a free Queens Public Library tote bag. The tax deadline is approaching. Queens Public Library has a resource list of partner organizations who can provide you with virtual tax help this year. Visit our blog on queenslibrary.org for more information.
Hello and welcome. My name is Amy Willis and I'm at the Queens Library at Hunters Point. Welcome to Queens Public Library's What Happens When We Flush? New York City's Wastewater Story. Today's program is one of the many for the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center. And we hope to see you at our next program on April 9th at 2 p.m. Beneath the Waves, Bringing Oysters Back to New York Harbor. Check the comments as we'll be adding these links to future events so you can add and set a reminder. These programs are made possible by the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. If you have any questions for our speaker, Robin Sanchez, please write them in the live chat and we'll have a Q&A audience participation at the end of this session. We are pleased to introduce Robin Sanchez. She is the Director of Education for the New York City Department of Environmental Protection. And as Director of Education, Robin leads DEP's Education Office in developing environmental education programs and resources for pre-kindergarten through college students and educators in New York City and upstate watershed communities. Visit DEP's website to learn more. And without further ado, take it away, Robin. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Amy. Hi, everyone. Hope you're all having a good afternoon. Today we're going to be talking about the Newtown Creek Wastewater Resource Recovery Facility, which is the largest facility out of all of New York City's wastewater treatment plants throughout our five boroughs. And so we're going to be talking more about what happens to our wastewater once it goes down our drains, where does it go, how does our sewer system collect all this water, and then where does it end up? And specifically, we'll focus in on the Newtown Creek facility since it is so close to the Queens Public Library in Long Island City. So let's jump right in. So who is DEP? Who are the people that I work with? There are about 6,000 of us throughout New York City. And our job is to protect public health and the environment for New Yorkers. And we do this in a few different ways. We are in charge of supplying and protecting all of the drinking water for the city, for all of the commuters and tourists that are in and out of our city each day. And we supply about 1 billion gallons of water every day to just over 9 million New Yorkers. It's also our job to then collect and clean all of the wastewater that we produce. So all of the water, once it goes down our drains after using it, and all the waste that comes with it, that's our job to collect it through the sewer system and clean it properly before it's released back into the natural environment around New York City. And we also work to reduce air, noise, and hazardous waste pollution throughout the city as well. We're a unique agency in that most of us are right here in the five boroughs, about 5,000 of us, but about 1,000 people work upstate throughout our watershed communities, collecting and protecting, as I mentioned, our drinking water. So I want to talk a little bit about our drinking water and where it comes from first, just to give us that idea of this whole system and how it provides us with our resources, and then we'll get into what happens afterwards to our wastewater. So think a little bit about how you use water each day, and the ways that we need it to keep our bodies clean, to stay hydrated, to stay alive, but also to keep our homes and communities clean as well. So whether it was flushing the toilet, brushing your teeth, drinking water, showering, those are some of our usual activities. Maybe this weekend you'll do some laundry or wash dishes and cook. All of this is really important. We at DEP want to know, how do New Yorkers use water and how much water do you use? So we measure water in gallons. So consider 1 gallon of water as our measurement and think about how many gallons of water do you, the average New Yorker, use each day? So I'll give everyone a couple moments. You can drop your answer in the chat if you have an idea. If you think it's 30 gallons, 65, 120, or 215 gallons per person per day. So take a moment to do that. And I'll reveal our answer. And we're going to have a couple trivia questions kind of sprinkled throughout the program just to see how much you already know and hopefully share some fun facts about our water systems. So our answer here is C, 120 gallons. Each one of us uses around 120 gallons of water every day. And this all adds up for New York City. As I mentioned before, we use about 1 billion gallons in total. So where does this water come from? It's coming from about 100 miles north of us, where we have 3 watersheds throughout upstate New York that collect rain and snow or precipitation. And that rain or snow falls down by gravity, makes its way into 19 reservoirs and 3 lakes, where all together we can store about 570 billion gallons of water. So DEP is actually the largest combined water and wastewater municipality in the country, and a lot of that has to do with just how much water we are supplying and managing through these systems. So one of the things I'll point out here is just not only the scale, but you notice the natural environment. So this area, what we call a watershed, is just the natural area of land that collects that rain and snow. And we're really fortunate that where our drinking water comes from, much of this land is forested, which helps to protect and naturally filter our drinking water. So this map gives us a sense of just how far that water comes from about 100 miles, 125 miles at the furthest point, all the way down to New York City. And it travels to us by gravity through aqueducts and water tunnels beneath the ground that help that water slowly make its way down to New York City. It could take several weeks for a drop of water to travel this whole system before it gets to our sinks and our faucets. And one other thing I want to point out here is just not only the size of this system, but also the history. Our water supply system dates back to the early 1800s when we first began to explore water resources north of New York City. And eventually, as our city grew, we expanded the system to be able to collect more drinking water and supply it down to us. So each day we use about 1 billion gallons of water for all the people living in New York City, also some towns north of the city, of course, commuters and tourists that are in and out of the five boroughs each day as well. And so now I want to get into what happens after we use that water? What happens to all of our waste and everything that gets flushed down our drains? So this is called wastewater, and it's not only the used water, but it's the human waste or poop, food waste or grease from our kitchen sinks, hair, soap, shampoo, everything that goes down our shower drains. And sometimes things that people really shouldn't flush down the drain, like wet wipes or hygiene products that end up getting flushed and will head down into our sewer system. Now, our sewers in New York City and our wastewater treatment system are not only collecting your wastewater, but also stormwater off of our streets when it rains or when snow melts. So this could make up about 3.6 billion gallons of wastewater and stormwater that gets collected through the system each day. This is what our sewer system probably reminds you of if you ever see the covers on top of the ground, the round covers, or these catch basins or storm drains throughout our streets and sidewalks. And so these are just parts of this huge system for our sewers. Beneath New York City, we have about 7,500 miles of sewer pipes. And I like to think about that if you were to take a trip from New York to California, it's about 3,000 miles. So if you would stretch out all of our sewer pipes, it could get you there, back, and even have more length to go before you travel the whole system. And this is all, again, happening beneath our feet, underneath New York City streets. Now, our system also includes these catch basins here that capture rain and snow melt off of our streets. We have over 144,000 catch basins. And we also have 96 wastewater pumping stations throughout the city. Like I mentioned earlier, our drinking water flows to us mostly by gravity. And the same thing happens here in the city. Most of our sewers allow water to flow by gravity towards a facility or towards a waterway. But the city itself is much more flat and in a lot of areas pretty low-lying to waterways. So it's necessary for us to be able to also use energy to pump water up so that it can continue to flow down towards its destination. So DEP manages this system, and of course there are sometimes things that get flushed down our drains that can cause pretty big clogs. And once you have a clog in the sewer pipe, it can cause a backup, meaning dirty water can go back up into homes or out onto our streets. So take a moment here and think about which item on this list causes the most clogs and sewer backups. Just think about this one. It's a little tricky, a little bit of a trick question. Go ahead and add your answer to the chat if you have an idea. So any one of these items could definitely cause a clog in your drain at home, in your plumbing fixtures. But the one that's always caused some issues for New York City has been bee cooking grease. Leftover cooking grease and oil combined with other things like wet wipes that have become very popular in the last several years or hygiene products can cause really large clogs. We call these fatbergs. It's pretty gross looking. A fatberg is this mass of grease and oil that has hardened and cooled within the sewer. And as other products are flushed down the drain, it creates this even larger mass called a fatberg that can clog our drain and cause a sewer backup. So this is unsanitary. This is something that is a challenge for us. We have to maintain these sewer pipes. We want to make sure that waste is not going back towards people's homes, but that it's being collected properly and cleaned. So think about what you do at home. Do you do anything differently? And if you want to add to the chat, but what are some ways that we can make sure grease and oil doesn't go down our drain? We could definitely let our pots and pans cool off after cooking and take a paper towel and just soak up or absorb and wipe off some of that grease. If it's a lot of oil, sometimes people like to save their oils and reuse it for flavoring and cooking other things, so not using new oil each time. Or if you've ever noticed, maybe your family has an old can or bottle on the countertop filled with this kind of congealed grease and oil, that's another great way of handling it, putting it into a container. Once it starts to harden and cool, then disposing of it and getting rid of it. And that's the best way to handle all this grease and oil that comes with cooking at home. We don't want that grease or oil getting down into our drains because, as we see here, fatbergs can not only cause issues, but cost a lot of money to repair in our system. And the reason it's so important in New York City is because most of our sewer pipes are combined, meaning they are not only capturing our wastewater from home, but they're also capturing all of the stormwater from our streets when it rains or snows. And this picture here just shows us what we experience. If you've ever been walking down the street when it's raining and you step in a puddle and your foot gets wet, that is stormwater. That's stormwater runoff that hit the ground from precipitation and was flowing over these hard surfaces like streets and sidewalks that don't absorb the water naturally and creates these puddles and could create floods as well. So that's why we have so many of these catch basins to try and collect and convey stormwater down into the sewers and get it off of our streets to make sure we don't have flooding issues. What you'll notice, though, and you've probably seen this walking in your neighborhood, there's always a lot of other things that get collected with the rain. Things like litter, bottles, cans, plastic bags, cigarette butts, things like that. But also dog waste, car oil, and other potential pollutants that could be collected with the water. So another trivia question for you here. Approximately what percent of New York City is impervious, meaning these hard concrete surfaces that cover our streets, our sidewalks, a lot of our rooftops, and that do not absorb any rainwater when it falls? What percent? Think about this. It's a good question for us to know as we're in our concrete jungle of New York City. How much of it is really concrete? The answer here is C. It's about 72%. This is an estimate for the amount of our land around New York City that is impervious. And again, that means that water cannot get through it, it cannot infiltrate into the ground, and it creates this runoff and flooding and all this excess water that'll end up in our sewer pipes. So 72%, that means that less than 30% of our landscape around New York City is natural. But we are working to try and improve that in a lot of different ways. And I'm going to talk about that a little bit more later. But let's see what this combined sewer looks like. So most of New York City has a combined sewer system, which, as I mentioned, collects wastewater and also stormwater into the same location. We can see that here on our graphic, the wastewater in orange and stormwater in blue. It'll mix together in the pipe beneath your neighborhood street and will end up going to a facility. Now, when the combined sewers were built for New York City, like most older cities rely on this system, it was innovative at the time. It was a way to get waste from homes, from horses and livestock, from our streets and industry, away from people, and get that water with stormwater out towards our waterways. And this was before we ever had a system in place to properly clean this water. But that can cause some issues, and this system still has a bit of a legacy with pollution. So what happens when we get a bigger storm, let's say a moderate to heavy rainstorm? Well, there's going to be too much water entering into this pipe. And rather than water going back out onto our streets or into homes or flooding our facilities, the combined sewer system is built to allow for some of it to overflow. And this is called a combined sewer overflow, or CSO. It doesn't happen every time it rains, but it can happen when we have these heavier wet weather events. And I usually just think of it kind of like filling a glass of water. If it's already half full with the wastewater that's going to be flowing through the system, and then all of a sudden you start to pour more water into it, eventually it's going to overflow. It's going to max out capacity. So we'll talk a little bit more about what DEP and New York City are doing to manage this challenge, to make sure that wastewater and stormwater and the pollutants that it can carry are not impacting our waterways as we continue on with the program. But I want to show you what the other 40 or so percent of New York City relies on. We also have separate sewers. In this case, you have two pipes beneath your street, one that collects your wastewater and sends it directly to a facility, and another pipe that collects stormwater runoff from the streets and sidewalks and any pollutants it picks up, and it'll head straight to the nearest waterway. Now, no matter how much it rains here, this stormwater and the litter it picks up will go directly out to our waterways. So both systems present some challenges, and we are, again, as I mentioned, working to help mitigate or reduce the harm that these systems during a big rainstorm can impact our waterways. There was a question that came in from the audience about what do we do with all the fats and grease that we collect if we collect it on in a can or from our pots and pans. The best thing to do is to throw it in the trash. So if you are going to dispose of it, if you're not reusing the oils, you can throw any greasy napkins or paper towels in the trash and any collected grease from a can in the trash as well. So this map here shows us our 14 facilities. We have 14 wastewater resource recovery facilities around New York City. And what you'll notice are these different areas in different colors. Now these are showing us the drainage basins. So each facility has a certain drainage basin, meaning if you live in the neighborhood within that area, your wastewater will head to that particular facility. We're going to focus in on Newtown Creek, which is right there in the center of the map in the blue drainage area. And it's located in Greenpoint, Brooklyn, near to the library. And it collects wastewater for all of downtown Manhattan and along the upper east side up to around the east 70s, and then much of North Brooklyn and also a small part of Queens. But looking at this map, try and get an idea of where your wastewater may end up once you flush your drains and your toilet. And I want to point out three of the facilities that were the first we ever built. So the first facility was Coney Island back in 1886, and it was built in the Sheepshead Bay neighborhood of Brooklyn. And you can see it towards the bottom of the map there in gray. And then several years later, we built the 26th Ward facility, and then eventually the Jamaica facility. You'll notice it's all three kind of surrounding Jamaica Bay, which is a really important natural ecosystem protecting New York City, but also near to our beaches, our local beaches and the Atlantic Ocean, so where people were using these waterways. So before we can get into how we treat wastewater, let's think about why we treat wastewater. So a lot of different reasons, but it really comes down to protecting, again, public health and the environment. So to make sure we prevent disease from the bacteria that comes from our bodies, all those microorganisms from our waste, making sure that that's not getting into any other water sources, handling pests like mosquitoes and rodents, and of course, all the odors that come with waste and the buildup of wastewater. And then it all comes back to protecting our waterways. So let's take a closer look at how that all happened. Looking at some of these really cool historical images of how we first began to understand our harbor, to understand how we were impacting our harbor by not properly treating our wastewater prior to the 1880s. That was really important. Around the time that we began to notice that our harbor was being affected and we needed to begin to build these facilities to properly clean our waste, we also were starting to go out onto our waterways and to test the water. We wanted to understand the health of the water. And we started to do that back in 1909. It's been more than 100 years, and we can say that water quality around New York Harbor today is the cleanest it's been since the Civil War. So really important shift in the protecting the harbor and making sure the health of the harbor is at its best. And it all has to do with building out these proper systems to clean our wastewater. Now, looking at this map here, the map on the left is from 1985 and on the right is from a few years ago, 2018. You'll just notice these difference in colors, but what it's showing us is the levels of fecal coliform that could be found in the water. And fecal coliform is an indicator of waste, and in particular human waste that could have been getting out. So after a combined sewer overflow, for example. Why 1985? Why are we showing that here? Well, the facilities, as I mentioned, we began building them in 1886, but it took about 100 years to build all 14 facilities before we had all 14 online. And then even during the 70s into the early 2000s, we were upgrading all of our facilities to make sure that the wastewater that we were cleaning, it always meets state and federal standards, and to make sure that our facilities are efficient at doing their job at cleaning the wastewater. One thing I'll point out, though, looking at 2018, it definitely looks much better, right? But you'll notice if you look in close, there are still some of these smaller waterways. Some of them are these kind of tributary waterways or dead-end waterways that aren't getting as much flow of water passing through each day. And they are still affected by combined sewer overflows and by stormwater pollution that could be getting out after a rain event. So that's where we've been focusing now. How can we make sure that these waterways can continue to remediate and be restored to their best water quality? So let's take a closer look at Newtown Creek. Here's our bird's eye view of the facility. It's the largest in New York City, meaning that it cleans the most wastewater. It has a capacity to clean over 300 million gallons of wastewater on a dry day. And on a wet weather day where all that stormwater comes into the system, it can clean more than double that. So over 600 into the 700 million gallons each day. It's near to Newtown Creek, which is what separates Greenpoint or Brooklyn from Long Island City, Queens. And it's also close to the East River, which is where the water goes once it's done being cleaned. So the first step of treatment is what we call preliminary treatment. This is where we use a physical process, meaning we physically remove any large items that we can see. And the way that we do this is by screening it. So the water will come through from the sewers and it'll come in contact with these bar screens that are a few inches apart, meaning water can pass through, but any large items like wet wipes, trash that could have come in after a storm, or any other debris will be removed from the water. And that's what's happening here. And we see some pretty interesting stuff. Once in a while, we get some interesting things that flow through the sewers and end up here. At our Newtown Creek facility a couple months ago, I believe we had found a whole bicycle somehow made its way through the sewers and ended up getting screened out. We've also found big logs from some of the industrial sites in the area that somehow get through the system. And one of our facilities out in Queens, we don't know why, but they get a lot of baby toys come in. So you never know. Weird things come through the sewers, and it's our job to take all of that waste out of the water. So because some of these items can cause some problems, as we mentioned before, the fatbergs can damage our sewers. Well, they can also damage these screens. They can jam them up and break the equipment, and it costs a lot of money to repair. So we have a rule, which is only flush the four P's. Four words that start with the letter P that are okay to flush down your toilet. Just take a moment if you'd like in the chat and add what you think the four P's are. What are the four words that start with the letter P that are okay to flush down your toilet? I think most of you probably got this. There's only one that's a little bit tricky, but it's pee, poop, puke, and toilet paper. Those are the only things that really should go down your drain. Anything else, as we see, can cause some pretty big problems. Now, all of that litter and debris that gets removed from the water during the first step is going to be sent to a landfill or a garbage dump. We're not separating anything out that could have been recycled or disposed of properly. Unfortunately, once it gets to us, it's all garbage. The next step is where we focus on some of the smaller items, things like grit and gravel, sand, coffee grounds or grains, and maybe some grease that's floating on the water. And what we do is bring the water into a tank, like what you see here, and we slow the flow down. And from this picture, you can kind of see what's in the water. We're going to give it some time with gravity to let anything heavy start to sink and anything light float. And we're going to skim off the scum and remove the grit, and this is all going to landfill as well. Now we can focus on the biology of the wastewater, meaning all that waste that came from our bodies, how are we going to get it out of the water? So what we do is we add air to our tanks, our aeration tanks, and the air is going to help create an environment for certain types of microbes or microorganisms, aerobic microorganisms that are going to thrive in that environment. And that's what you see in the picture on the right here. That's from one of our microscopes at the Newtown Creek facility. We actually just create this environment and give it some time, a few hours. And during that time, the aerobic microbes are going to start to eat and collect all of that organic waste, meaning food waste, human waste, poop, and any paper fibers that are kind of suspended or floating around the water. And as it does that, it gets nice and heavy, and it'll start to all sink to the bottom. So you can see that starting to kind of flock or come together in these clumps in the microscope. So the reason we do this is because it's a great way of removing the majority of the solids that are found in the water. So we call this sludge. Sludge is all of that bacteria, solid waste from poop, food waste, or paper fibers that's going to be sinking and removed from our tanks. So here, again, we use gravity to let that sludge sink, and we remove it to send to a different tank where it'll be treated. At this point, the water is almost pollutant-free. It's going to go through one last step of disinfection, and we use sodium hypochlorite. It's the same chemical that you would find in household bleach. The water will come in contact with that for about 10 minutes. It passes through this tank, and then it's on its way out to the East River. So it's been cleaned, and now it's going to become part of the natural water cycle again. But a big important step is not just keeping these tanks and machines running each day to clean our wastewater, but it's also having scientists on site who are testing each step of the way, testing the water to see how much bacteria has been removed, making sure other pollutants are removed, and just getting a sense of once it goes through the system, has it been cleaned properly? Is it going to meet standards before that water gets released back to the East River? Depending on where your facility is, whichever waterway is closest is usually the waterway that your wastewater, once it's cleaned, is released back into. So another last question for us here. How long do you think it takes to treat your wastewater? So think about when it gets to Newtown Creek, the facility, to once it's cleaned and it's back out to the East River. How long does that process take? Just take a moment and add your answer to the chat. I mentioned earlier that it takes a few weeks for us to get our drinking water from upstate. So it makes you think about how long it takes for water to travel, especially by gravity, to get someplace. But once it's at our facility, it is a fast process. It only takes about 8 to 10 hours to clean your wastewater. So if you use the bathroom when you woke up this morning, your wastewater is being cleaned right now, and by the end of the day, when you're getting ready for dinner or finishing up, cleaning up from dinner, your water has been cleaned and it's back out to the natural environment. It's a very fast process to do that. What takes a little bit longer is the sludge process. All this sludge, the solid waste, what are we going to do with it? Well, we're going to put it into a tank called a digester. And at Newtown Creek, we have these unique digesters that are egg-shaped, which you can see here. Maybe you've seen them from the area, especially if you're along the BQE, you can actually spot them. Sometimes they're lit up blue or another color at night. These digesters act just like your stomach. So when you eat, if you had lunch or you're going to have a snack or dinner in a little bit, your body starts to break down your food. And as it does that, your body gives off liquid waste, solid waste, and gas, right? A burp sometimes. So these tanks do the same thing. They are cleaning the organic solids, the waste, the sludge inside the tank. And as they do that, the microorganisms in this tank are going to start to break down all that waste and give off gas. So we can take a look at what that looks like. But one important thing to note here is not only do they mimic your stomach, but they're also made to do that. We keep the temperature nice and warm at about 98 degrees Fahrenheit, just like your body temperature, so that we can mimic that process of digestion. So the picture on the top is what it looks like from the top of the digester eggs. If you ever have a chance to come visit us at Newtown Creek, you can actually take a tour and you could go to the top of the digester eggs about 145 feet up and look in from a little window to see the sludge being mixed around. And that's what it looks like. It's nice and bubbly with all that gas that's being produced and ready for a big burp out of the tank. Now, one of the things that we've been doing in recent years is actually diverting food waste that would otherwise go to a landfill. So after you eat food, if you have leftover food scraps, and if you ever toss them in the trash, they would go to a landfill where, as the food breaks down, it also gives off gas, right? If you ever get an odor, or you can see some of how the food would break down in your fridge, or if you leave it out for too long. Well, what we've been doing is working with partners around the city to collect food scraps from schools, businesses like grocery stores and restaurants, and it gets collected. And by one of our partners, Waste Management, it's then turned into what you see in the bottom right, this smoothie called bioslurry. And that bioslurry is full of rich nutrients that we add to the sludge. And by doing this, we're actually helping to make sure that food waste doesn't end up in a landfill, and instead it can get digested in the tank, and it can help produce ultimately more biogas. So biogas is really methane gas, mostly methane gas, that can be captured from the tank and recovered and used for energy. It could be used to heat the facility. Now, at Newtown Creek, it's used in our boilers to help heat our buildings and provide heat to the digesters, keep them nice and warm. And we have so much of this gas, we're working with National Grid And they are actually going to be purifying it later this year, getting it ready to put it right into their pipeline, their natural gas pipeline in Greenpoint. And so people who live in the neighborhood in North Brooklyn might actually be turning on their heat next winter. And some of that natural gas could have originally come from their body's waste. So it's a really cool way that we are taking our New York City waste and turning it into resources. Speaking of resources, what happens to all the sludge? Once we take the gas out and we've treated it, we make sure that it's free of pollutants and bacteria, what happens to it? Well, it's going to go on a boat that you see here. This is one of our 5 sludge vessels, and it'll go to one of our 14 facilities that has the capacity to dewater. And that basically means we dry it out or spin it to remove the water from the sludge. And we do this because we want to get it to be like soil. And this is what you can see here, what it becomes. So the end product is what we call biosolids. And that just means that the sludge has been cleaned, it's been dewatered or dried out, and it now can become soil that's added to fertilizer or agricultural soils. It could be composted or used in other beneficial ways. So again, we are taking your waste, goes through the system, we turn it into resources like clean water that goes back to our waterways, biosolids that can be used on land, and biogas that can be used as renewable energy at our facilities or in our communities. And we're going to watch a video in a little bit where we'll actually see how that process works. But why do we do this? Well, it all comes back to protecting our waterways, right? Remember that there's this long history of building out this system, making sure it functions each day and it's collecting our waste and stormwater. Well, we continue today to try and help improve water quality around New York City. And we've noticed that, as I mentioned earlier, it has improved in many ways, but the two big ways that we see that are through the data that we still collect each day through our harbor survey program, testing the water around the city, but also through anecdotal accounts, meaning stories that we've heard in the news and from people around the city seeing more dolphins and humpback whales and sharks coming in and out of our harbor and coming to these waterways because there's more food for them to eat and the water is much cleaner than it's ever been. Some of the work that we continue to do is around green infrastructure. The bottom picture here is a close-up of a rain garden. So we've been building rain gardens around New York City. We have over 10,000 different types of rain gardens and green infrastructure like green roofs that help to collect water when it rains. And when they do that, that helps to make sure that extra rainwater doesn't end up in our sewers and cause combined sewer overflows. So these are all the different ways that this system works and how DEP helps to continue to improve it. But there's a lot of things that we actually look to New Yorkers for help with. And that includes making sure grease and oil doesn't end up down our drains, maybe helping out. We have all these new rain gardens we've been building. And we have a new program called Harbor Protectors, where New Yorkers can actually volunteer to help clean our rain gardens, add some new plants and flowers, make sure that they're staying nice and safe and working properly in your neighborhood. And we also, part of that Harbor Protectors program is making sure we're not putting litter and trash on our streets or dog poop, throwing things out properly, recycling them. And we sometimes do some cleanup events in different neighborhoods just to make sure that before a storm especially, our catch basins are clean and our neighborhoods are clean. Another big way to help out is by conserving water. Not only is this drinking water that we have amazing and we're so lucky to have such a huge system and a huge supply of water, but we know that when it rains, all the water that we flush down our drains is mixing and can create these overflow vents. So if we're able to conserve water to not only protect this resource, but also when it rains, we can actually help reduce overflows from happening. later this month, you might see in the news that we're going to announce a new phone app that you can download for free. And it's called the Wait app. And the idea is that it'll tell you when a big storm is coming, and it'll give you tips on how to wait to use water. So a big storm is on its way. We expect an overflow to happen in your neighborhood. Please hold off on doing laundry or washing dishes until whatever time. And so we hope people get involved with that and have a better understanding of how we impact our sewers. And the last thing, again, is just keeping trash out of our waterways to help not only protect us and the waterways, but of course, all the plants and animals that call New York Harbor our home as well. So we have a couple videos that we're going to get to in just a moment, but I wanted to share our email address and also our website. You can find out a lot more information. And in the chat, you'll also find three other website links. One is to our virtual tours, which if you want to see this process up close by video, it's a great way to check that out. So there's a wastewater treatment virtual tour. There's also three other virtual tours, one about our watershed, where drinking water comes from, lots of cool video interviews from our DEP staff upstate. There's one about the sewer system and the history of the sewers, and there's another about harbor water quality and how we're protecting our harbor. There's two other websites that were added, one about visiting, so if you ever want to come visit us in person. And we have this awesome nature walk that is along the edge of the Newtown Creek facility and along Newtown Creek and Whale Creek waterways. And it was just recently expanded, and it features this really cool, we call it phase two and phase three section, where you can walk over Whale Creek and check out all these different hidden features of the nature walk. So take a look at those sites. Let us know if you have any questions. And I think now we're going to watch a couple of videos.
The Bureau of Wastewater Treatment relies on 1,800 professionals in our field to treat and recover valuable resources for the city's wastewater.
No matter if you're a carpenter, plumber, iron worker, welder, electrician, instrumentation personnel, biologists, chemists, who can help New York City maintain its waterways and help save the environment.
It's important to monitor the wastewater treatment because you want to make sure that that water is clean going outside this facility.
So the flow coming in, when I compare with the flow going out, you can see all the results that goes into treating wastewater.
We are here to prove that things are being treated right.
You can fish now. We couldn't fish now in New York City waters before, but now you can. Our harbors are very clean.
You know, New York City is getting the wells back. That's a product of everybody's work and, you know, the 14 wastewater treatments. That's the result.
Wastewater never rests. That's why we exempt you.
We're going to watch one more video. I hope you enjoyed that one there of some of the folks who work at our facilities. Let's check out this second video now.
How are our facilities assets to the community? In addition to protecting public health and the environment, what if we told you that we could heat a building with your poop? Just like your stomach processes food to produce energy for your body, at our facilities, we have giant mechanical stomachs that digest New York City's waste. During this process, we produce clean water that is safely released back into the environment, biosolids, which can be used as fertilizer, and energy. Just like you release gas after a big meal, our mechanical stomachs release gas when they digest the organic materials in wastewater. We can capture this biogas and use it as energy. We've also proven through innovative partnerships that our facilities can simultaneously digest the organic materials in wastewater and in process food scraps. Food scraps that go to landfills decompose and release methane, a potent greenhouse gas. By digesting food scraps, we're capturing more biogas and reducing greenhouse gas emissions.
Hey, Robin.
Hi, Amy.
Hey, that was a great presentation. Let me just, so I'm just going to read a quick thank you to everybody. So thank you, Robin, and a big thank you to the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. Please like and share this video, as this event will be available for viewing after. And in addition, subscribe to the QPL channel to get more updates on similar upcoming programs. Links for all the replays of upcoming events, replays of past events, or more links related to the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center in the live chat. And we hope to see everyone on April 9th at 2 p.m. beneath the waves, bringing oysters back to New York Harbor. And so couple of questions that came up for me is, do you actually work with the different conservation groups in the area? So like the Hudson River Conservation Group, and if so, in what way?
Yeah, that's a great question, Amy. We definitely work with community organizations and environmental advocacy groups around New York City. It could be to collaborate. Through our team, it's collaborating on a lot of education programs. So we work together to provide workshops to teachers and do school programs on different related topics and events. But these groups are also helping to check in with us. They, you know, we monitor and manage a huge system. So to know that local community groups are aware of issues, ongoing issues that might be happening in their neighborhoods, whether it's water quality or, you know, working with other agencies like parks to get access to locations, mm-hmm. they can help keep us honest and make sure that we're aware of these issues that are going on. So mm-hmm. it's a really great way to just continue partnerships with different organizations. We rely on them, and we can help also maintain these systems to protect their communities.
Mm-hmm. And a few years ago, I want to say it was like maybe 2011, 2012, I read about a very interesting call for submissions for ways to increase the water quality and health in the New York area. And one of the things that they discussed was actually oysters in the bay, I think was part of it. Were there any submissions that dealt with the water treatment plants, or you know, can you talk any about different kinds of, you know, suggestions that people have had that you've taken up?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I don't know too much about what you're referring to, but I do know that, you know, one of our partners is Billion Oyster Project. I know that you'll be having them join you next week, which is great. Mm-hmm. And a couple sites we've been helping to install oyster beds, trying to restore oysters throughout the harbor. We've also been working in a couple areas to add in mussels as well, where mussels were once popular in those waterways, and to help with filtering water quality. And then a big thing is really around our green infrastructure program, making sure that we're looking at neighborhoods near to waterways that still need our help in managing stormwater better and protecting these waterways from overflow events. Mm-hmm. So we've been, since around 2010, building out green infrastructure throughout those neighborhoods. We've since expanded to other neighborhoods, but rain gardens are our most common, and we've been working with a lot of these partner organizations to help steward and volunteer to protect these rain gardens. They need some love and care. There's so many of them. So it's hard for us, even though we go on a weekly basis to clean and maintain them, our crews, but having other New Yorkers help us, like these organizations and like everyday volunteers who join us, has been amazing. So mm-hmm. there's different things that we've been focusing on to try and help improve water quality, and those are just a couple of the ways.
There was actually a water garden over in Elmhurst, right off of Broadway, that I would sit next to and have my coffee at every day. And I loved watching the cycle of, like, you know, what would happen when it would rain and what would pop up like a week later in terms of plants. And then, you know, kind of every time I would go by, I would kind of pick out the litter and things like that. So I love those water gardens. They're amazing. And then anecdotally, I just wanted to share, when I lived in California in the 80s, it was during a lot of drought time. So we had really severe droughts for many years. And there was a little saying that we were all taught in school. And it was, if it's yellow, let it mellow. If it's brown, flush it down.
Right.
And I sort of live by that motto even now. Like I try to put all my waste in a trash can next to the, you know, toilet, and then be conscious of like what I'm using in terms of water and turning the water on and off. But I think it was like in the training from being in that drought environment in California really like affected how I see water conservation and water use. So that was very interesting. And I loved seeing the way that all of the different biofuel, biogas, and everything is used. I had no idea there was so much recycling of resources in the water treatment process. So
yeah, it's definitely you know, a standard wastewater treatment system in many ways, but the way that DEP and New York City as a whole has been able to implement such innovation towards recovering resources from our waste, I think is so cool. Newtown Creek is kind of at the forefront of that out of the 14 facilities, but the other facilities are doing it in different ways. One of our facilities has solar panels installed. We're planning to do that at another location. Another one of our facilities in the Bronx is going to soon have digester eggs installed to be able to help capture that biogas even more. So there's a lot of potential for making these sites even more sustainable and at the forefront of innovation for the future for our city. So really cool projects going on. And I'll just mention, you know, you mentioned drinking water and that saying. I think that's so important. I think it's hard for us in New York City. We're so far from where our water comes from, you know, 100 miles, that often New Yorkers are unfamiliar with where our drinking water comes from and unsure of, you know, is it safe? Is it clean? That sort of thing. So it's really good to know where it comes from, to have this idea. If you're able to ever visit up into the Catskill Mountains or even up into Westchester County to see some of the lakes and reservoirs, and just to see how amazing this resource is. But conservation is still important, even though we have so much water available to us and we don't deal with drought the same scale. There's one project I'll just mention is we're repairing one of our aqueducts, the Delaware Aqueduct, and we are almost towards the end of the repair project, which will involve shutting down the aqueduct for several months later this year to finish the repairs. So we're definitely going to be calling on New Yorkers to help us conserve water, be more conscious of how much we use on a daily basis because of these projects.
Well, this is great. Thank you so much for being with us today, Robin. It was really a pleasure to see your presentation, and I learned so much. I'm hoping, you know, the rest of the audience learned as much as well. So thank you so much.
Of course. Thanks so much for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. And hopefully we'll see you back here again.
Sounds great. Thanks, everyone.
Have a great day. Bye-bye.
Take care.
Take care.